I feel in it.
This program is about people who have created a mark for themselves. And such people, when they come to us in our life, they brighten it up with their own experiences. Today in the studio, we have with us Mr. Ramprakash Singhal. He was born in India in Punjab, and currently he works as a director in a consulting firm in New York. He went to the West in 1977. Mr. Ramprakash Singhal has been practicing Raj Yoga meditation since a very long time, and he strongly believes that it is because of this practice he has been able to leverage his professional life and also his personal life. And thereby he has been able to contribute to the society also. One such campaign that he's passionate about is the 7 billion acts of goodness. This campaign is to spread environmental and social awareness in the society. He has traveled extensively across the globe to spread message of peace, happiness, and prosperity. Mr. Ramprakash Singhal was also a part of the Twin Towers attack that happened, and he's been a survivor of that entire incident. And he has some very essential things to share with us. And so let us welcome him in the studio and see what he has to offer. A warm welcome to you.
Thank you so much, Shobhit.
We hear so much in your profile, in your data, that how you have been successful in your professional life, and also all that work that you're doing in the society to spread this goodness around. How do you balance it?
You know, I find that lots of times people think that our personal life is different than our professional life. But what I have seen over a period of time, actually, you cannot separate them both. Because whatever values you have developed within yourself on a personal level, same thing actually also are handy towards my professional life. Because after all, the people who come to work, they also are social people. They also have their social life. So it's dealing with human nature. And I find that because we are so much close to each other, when we think of, when we go beneath our skin, we are all very same. So whatever happens to me, it must be happening to other people too. And that is what I see, that how I behave, how I think about things, very likely other people are also thinking the same way. So based on my own experiences, I bring it up even in my professional life, and I find they really work.
Oh, that sounds very interesting. But then the whole idea of working in a consulting firm, which is in itself a 24/7 profession that we understand, and you traveling extensively for the social causes where you get no money, it's all free charity work that you do. So the thing is, you just mentioned about values, and you know, you have this thing in your life that helps you stand. But then the time, how you're able to find the time to travel so much and do all this work?
See, you brought out two things. One is about money, other is about time. I have seen in my own life, I have a humble background. There was a time we had a lot of business, then we lost the business. Since I was in ninth grade, we had very, very humble kind of situations. Then time came that I was well-to-do. I went to America, I was able to earn money. Then I had done small things, as well as I had been pretty successful in my professional life too. But when I overall see the life, I notice that actually what you get out of doing small things, they have a lot of value in our life. I have also seen people, even very successful people, they also are dealing with small things. See, I could be a big professional person in my business, but when I come home, I'm an ordinary person, like mother, father,
right,
brother, sister, at that time my professional skills are not going to work. They are going to be, what is my attitude, or my attitude towards the life. And that is how I see, when I take go to the professional life, I use my social skills. And when I am at home, or when I am going to church, when I am going to meditation center, because I take care of a lot of their professional things such as engineering, facilities management, project management, I use those skills in my social life as well. So what I find, I don't see any difference. Because I don't see any difference, I don't live like double life. It's the same life. Wherever I am, I am going to be whatever I am. So it works pretty good with me. And second comes with the money. And I find that, as I mentioned, that I had this experience, both humble background and also with wealth. But somehow or another, I find that what is our basic needs, they are very small. After that, it's all show off. And somehow I have seen both the situations where I deal with rich people, poor people, and I find that actually it's your dignity. It's your self-respect. That is more important than with the wealth. See, somehow I feel that the richness and poverty is related to how many needs I have.
Yeah.
If I have 50 needs and I earn 40 equal to 40 needs, I am poor. But supposing my needs are 30 and I am making 40, I am a rich person. So it is a relative.
So does that mean that since you strongly believe in working at the grassroots level and you had this humble background, and you just mentioned about you go to the center, did all that influence you to have your desires to the minimum, and somewhere that helped you also save money in a very practical and an easy manner?
See, when I say, it's not my desires became minimum. Now I realize with my own self, I am ambitious person, very ambitious. I think big. I say it does not take anything. It does not cost to imagine big things. It does not cost to have big dreams.
Right.
And you keep on working at it. But don't get stuck with one dream. See, lots of time people have one dream in their life, and when they get stuck, they are frustrated, they are depressed. They felt that their journey has stopped. But I believe you should have 7-8 dreams. And one dream comes to stand still, jump onto the other one. And then that comes to stand still, jump another one, and then another one. And in the meantime, maybe the first dream will open up. So this way you are always living in the dreamland where there's so much joy, fun. So it is a matter of you don't stop. You just keep on going from one to another. That way you become multifaceted. You also are able to change your pace of life. Then you are always going into the new things. So the life become very adventurous with that.
Lovely. It sounds quite interesting. Coming to another aspect of life, which is health. When we talk about balancing life, how do you look into that area?
See, I find our health has a lot to do how we think. I would say that I have wonderful experience with my body. I love my body.
Would love to know about those experiences.
See, like, there was a time I was young. I did not like my body at all. Like being a dark skin, I am the darkest in my own family. And I always used to have that kind of inferiority complex.
Oh.
But what I noticed was that I felt the persons who are good looking, they can get away with many things. But for me, I have to earn people's love and respect. And I was always willing to do extra work. I was willing to go an extra mile in order to win people's love and respect. And in that process, actually, I kept growing. In that way, I kept on getting better and better. And ultimately, I also started to notice people don't care how you look. They look at how you are, your behavior, your attitude. Are you helpful? So we call it inner beauty. And I find once you are able to see that people really don't care, then I start to find that even the body, I start to feel this is the body through which I am able to do so many good things. So shouldn't I love my body? Shouldn't I pat on my shoulder to give thank you to my body at the end of the day? And that's what I do. And that actually, it's just like you use the horse for the whole day, and then at the night time, you crash the horse, you know. And I do, literally I do.
Oh, really?
And I find all of a sudden, it's like I am shaken up with joy and I'm ready for the next task. So there is a efficiency and then also the willingness to do things. Plus, I want to see people smiling. I know if I do a little bit extra for anybody, I will have that smile coming on that person's face and it is going to come back to me.
This is something that I can resonate with, because definitely the idea of having a healthy mind leading to a healthy body, and the whole aspect that you just mentioned of walking that extra mile and doing that extra little bit brings a lot of inner happiness, and thereby it sort of radiates in the persona of the person. That is so nice. I'm sure that the viewers would have a lot of understanding from this this whole thing that you just mentioned. Your profile, your states about you going to the West. People like to serve and be in their own home country. What was it that took you to America in 77? Why is it that you haven't come back to India then?
See, it's an interesting thing. Actually, when I was in India, I used to think it's because of lack of resources we are fighting with each other. Because I used to think that, oh, we are fighting, we are angry with each other, and the reason being, maybe we don't have enough wealth, maybe somewhere we are lacking things. And whenever I used to see some American movies, people are always happy. I used to think they are very happy because they have a lot of things. So when I went to America, actually in the beginning, I used to feel that they are so disciplined. If the bus is coming and people cannot get onto it, they will not jump over each other. And they will just stay in the line. Even if the bus goes, they will wait for the next bus. I said, look how disciplined they are. Look in India, they're all rushing and jumping over each other. But then, after a while, I remember there was scarcity of oil one time. There was a problem with Iran at that time. And all of a sudden, I noticed people fighting with each other for the oil. Even if they have to wait for 5 minutes in line, they could not handle it and all that. And then I also see, like, I used to think people are always happy over there. But then I see all of a sudden somebody's crying in front of me. I say, oh my God, Americans, they cry as well. And then I also see people backbiting over there, like gossiping. I used to think only in India we gossip. But then I said, they gossip too. Or they cry too. And they get upset too. And then I just said to myself, oh, they do everything what we do. The difference is, we do it in Hindi, they do it in English. That's the only difference I saw.
Achcha.
So I saw that no difference as far as the human beings are concerned. We are all so much similar to each other. And that is where my thought was, I am going there to give them something, not to take. That was my my whole life had been. To give people rather than just going for desire to let what is in there for me. Somehow that worked very well for me.
So this whole aspect of the whole thought of giving, you know, that is, you just mentioned that the whole idea of giving to the people took you there. And now we see that that is something that has taken to places in the world. You've traveled in so many countries, not only India, and giving to the people. So somewhere, is this the thing that the whole foundation, the genesis of giving, serving, is something that has made you successful today?
One time I was thinking about that, Ram, why you are living? what is your mission of life? Early stage, I used to think, oh, I will be married, I will have beautiful car, I will have beautiful house, I will go to America and will be a successful person. But as I am going through my life, I started notice that whatever we aspire for, sometimes our desires, sometimes they could be so limited. Like I used to question myself, okay, I will have beautiful car, beautiful this thing, beautiful everything, whatever I need, it is at my disposal, then what? That's not life. Life is much, much more than that. And then as I am going through, like I was going through the humble background to becoming flourishing and all that. But one time I still remember, I was not feeling good. I was away with the family and all that. And I was in close to Chicago in America. I'm sitting on a bed in a hotel room. I have money. And I literally, I'm taking the money and I'm throwing. I said, what is this life? I have all the money I want, but I'm not happy. What this money is for?
And then?
And that was the time I really felt that, okay, what you're living for? And the thought came to my mind, I'm living for serving people. I am living to make people happy. At that time, I never thought that making people will make me happy.
Which year was that?
That was in 1979.
I mean, the time you just moved to America, just 2 years later.
Even like you could see, I was in dire financial crisis. And I had just come out a little bit out of it. And even at that time, I was able to see, if you are not happy, all the resources, they become meaningful. I was able to see, it's just like I have variety of food lying on the table and I get a bad news.
Mm.
The same delicious food will not go down my throat.
Mm. True.
You know, I could have beautiful bed, the big king size bed, but if I am restless, I won't be able to sleep.
But this is something that we have often heard. In, you know, we hear this in the society that happiness, if you target for happiness, then you'll get success.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what was it that made you find the true definition of happiness for your own life that has helped you be successful?
Perhaps you are trying to connect happiness with success.
Yes.
See, because your desire is to help other people.
Mm.
That was in my profession as well. Somehow, I never wanted to be jealous with anybody. Anytime anybody is jealous of whatever I am doing, I will find a very quiet way of giving that task to that person, and I will go in the unknown territory.
Sure.
And in that unknown territory, where there is, because there is a fear, there is uncertainty in the unknown territory.
Yeah.
Because you are going into the area you have never been.
Yes.
But what I find, courage and fear, they go together. They are at the same point. Either I could go towards the fear, or if I can just have a leap of courage, little bit courage, that's where the beauty is. Then you start to see new scenes. Then you start to see new life coming. That's where you find something new. What is adventure? Adventure is a similar kind of thing. There is a fear of falling, fear of getting hurt. But the excitement of finding something new is much, much bigger than that fear of losing.
So is
that is what I find my joy started to come. Every time I went into unknown territory, I felt adventurous and I felt happy about it, and also I made other person happy.
It is like you have found the purpose of your life, correct? Because for you, the purpose was to serve people that gave you a lot of happiness, which could be different for other people. For them, it could be some other reason why, what will give them happiness. But for you, it was to serve people that gave you happiness. And deep down, when you sat down in introspection 2 years later, and you just mentioned that whole scene when, you know, life seemed quite futile to you. So what advice you will give to people? I mean, you just mentioned about fear and courage. That is the point of decision making, isn't it?
That is where we find what is, because when we think of our life, it is not just a spur of moment, my life is. It is a long period of, like, it's building, it's evolving. And it's not only one way that, oh, I want to just make people happy. It is a overall picture. Like, for example, giving happiness to people, for some people it will be money, for some people giving a pat on their shoulder, for some it will be giving them the right advice at the right time. To some, even to be able to listen to them will give them happiness. So actually it combines everything. When we think of our life, that means once the goodness is there in your life, goodness entails all those things, and not just one or two things.
I can totally understand when you just mentioned this, because in my life too, I have had this situation where I have to make decisions, important decisions, this side or that side, and therefore the play of fear and courage. Didn't you have to think about people who are associated with you, linked with you, to seek their approval, to seek their permission, and if they are okay to take the consent? Because a lot of times when we take our decisions thinking that this is it, you know, this is what is meant for me, and I know it, that when I'll do it, I will fly high. But when I do that in that moment, I also realize that there are a lot of people around me who will be very, very unhappy. Did you have that moment?
See, but I find there could be moments what I think is good for other people, they may not think at that time. That is where I believe one thing deeply, my honesty and sincerity. If deeply I am really trying to help other people with my limited intellect even. Mm-hmm. I could be limited in my understanding of the thing, but I don't have to be limited in my sincerity and honesty. Mm-hmm. That does not have quantity in it. Mm-hmm. So that is where I find, once I am honest and sincere, even if I make a mistake, even I don't understand somebody, that what they really need. I could be making even mistake in understanding, but once I'm honest and sincere, I know they will understand sooner or later. And so they will be served in their right movement. They will find that I was helpful to them. That is where I find that you don't too much analyze things, don't strategize things. Don't try to become smart. Like, I find that if deep inside you want to give solution to people, you want to help people, time will come, they will realize and appreciate you. Maybe it might take a little time. That is where your other ability, patience, another understanding. When you sow a seed, each seed takes its own time before it sprouts. I just cannot be impatient and keep on digging the seed to see how far it has gone.
So it's about a clear conscience, honesty.
Yes.
And that will help you take that leap step. This is what I understand that you have just mentioned in this whole conversation. I'm sure that the viewers would have taken this understanding of about your own life experiences, especially the point that you mentioned, the defining factor in your life in 1979, that was honesty and sincerity, the time when you sat down to reflect, and that leap of step, courage and fear. Thank you so much for coming in the studio and sharing your life with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
So we were live in conversation with Mr. Ramprakash Singhal. We'll do more of these episodes in the coming segments. We have learned a lot in this program. I'm sure that the takeaway, the practical experiences of life have really enriched us. To me personally, definitely yes. And I'm sure that you will be coming again to learn and take benefit from this program. So I hope We'll be again together on this next fresh episode with Mr. Ramprakash Singhal. Thank you for watching.